You're listening to the audio production of While I Have Your Attention, It's Never Too Late for a New Beginning by Dr. Lucille O'Neill, published by Thomas Nelson, and read by Karen Chilton and Jeremy Michael Durm. I dedicate this memoir of my life experiences to my 16 grandchildren and 3 great-grandchildren. You were all birthed with a purpose. I leave you a legacy full of love and hope for your future. I want to remind you what I learned from your great-grandmother Odessa. God has the master plan for your life. Keep your head up and never forget to walk like you have somewhere to go. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. Proverbs 3, verses 5 through 6.
Foreword by Dr. Shaquille O'Neill. At around 8 o'clock a.m. on March 6, 1972, I had my first opportunity to gaze into the eyes of an angel. I couldn't have asked for a more perfect image as my first sight after arriving in the world that day. Her name is Lucille, and I've had the pleasure of calling her mother for the last 52 years. The woman who inspired me at every step of my own journey in the NBA and beyond gave up so much for me and my brother and sisters so we could have opportunities and lifestyles none of us could have ever dreamed of. As we moved from place to place with my father, Phil, who was in the Army, we never imagined all of what we had been able to achieve. Because my mom was just a teenager when I was born, we supported each other as we both grew and evolved over the years. I remember how hard she worked as a single mother, and then as a wife and caretaker to a house full of rambunctious, my sisters, stubborn, my brother, and well-behaved me. Kids. LOL. We never saw her down. She wouldn't allow it. And she balanced our lives, as well as her own, with the precision of a highly skilled neurosurgeon. She certainly kept me safe as a young man so that I could realize my dream of playing professional basketball. Through it all, she's never let me give up on myself, even when things seemed the most hopeless. Today, after my 19 years in the NBA, she's still the ultimate inspiration for everything I do. Watching her have the courage to return to school after age 40 and become single again after 28 years of marriage has given me the strength to face my opponents and anything else, both on and off the court, with little hesitation. I am what I am, and I have what I have, because of Lucille O'Neill's DNA running through my veins. Trust me, all who read this book will benefit from the wisdom I've been relying on for years. Thank you, Mommy. I love you. Shaquille O'Neill, number 33.
Preface. My life, and for the most part, the lives of my entire family, have been in the spotlight since the day my son, Shaquille, entered the NBA back in 1992. As far back as then, I've thought off and on about telling my own story. My life has always consisted of much more than just being the mother of a beloved sports icon or the recipient of massive fortune and fame. Oddly enough, throughout the years, I'd always convinced myself that it wasn't the right time. I've questioned whether anyone really wanted to hear what a New Jersey girl had to say. Why would they care? My thinking baffled Shaquille, who would regularly remind me of how inspiring my life's tale could be for the countless people out there facing the same obstacles and setbacks in their lives that I've faced in mine. Shaquille is my oldest child, and there is a 6-year age difference between him and his next sibling. So for several years, it was just the two of us trying to make it, which gave Shaquille, more than any of my other children, a front row seat to some of my darkest hours. Obviously, my son knows a good story when he lives one. Still, I hesitated to share my life in print. In hindsight, I realized that I hesitated because my story really didn't have all the necessary chapters until very recently. I had to come full circle with life's big events, like death, divorce, and renewal, before I could not only explain to people the meaning of my journey, but also how I'd come out on the other end and how they could do the same. After a very long and successful career in the NBA, the time came for my son to leave the basketball court. His retirement marked the end of much of the attention and fascination the public had with his personal life, something I can honestly say now I looked forward to. But it also hit me that the right time for me to lay it all out had finally arrived. The ups and downs and ins and outs of a life forever changed by a miracle, but still in progress, all while I have your attention. Chapter 1. Living in Confusion. When I stepped through the door of our three-story New Jersey home that bright summer afternoon, I knew my secret was a secret no more. On our deep beige, plastic-covered sofa in the living room sat my mother, Odessa, smiling pleasantly as usual, and my grandmother, Scylla, who, per usual, was not smiling at all. These two women were not the best of friends. In fact, they were far from it, which explained why they were sitting on opposite ends of the sofa. But something had brought them together on this fateful evening, and I was pretty sure it wasn't high tea. The two most prominent women in my world were there to confront me about something I'd chosen to ignore. In the previous weeks, my 17-year-old body had begun to change ever so slightly. I'd been skin and bones most of my young life, but suddenly I was putting on weight. My mornings before I departed for school were filled with constant trips to the bathroom to throw up, and nothing I ate stayed down for very long. These were all symptoms of a condition I was much too scared to even admit to myself was possible. This was 1971. Not long after the end of the civil rights movement, and still a time when being young, single, and pregnant was a thing of shame for the entire family. To add to my disgrace, I'd been raised in the most Christian of households, so my embarrassment would be all the worse. How could I have sinned like that? My grandmother asked with absolutely no patience for my answer. Her disapproving face said it all. I was crushed and ashamed that day. But this is exactly how the impending birth of my oldest child, Shaquille Rashawn, was announced at my home. Though I knew his arrival would change my life forever, I never guessed in just how many mind-boggling ways. As I sat there that day, listening to my grandmother lash out at me for all my sinful transgressions, I did what I often do when things became too much for me to handle. I zoned out. Why would I stay in that moment to hear my grandmother accuse me of being a hoe on wheels and a tramp and any other negative name she could think of? In retrospect, I think my grandmother was angry about a lot of things that day, things that had little to do with me. Her life hadn't exactly been rainbows and moonbeams, and I'd unwittingly provided her a perfect opportunity to unleash all that pent-up frustration on me. My mother, on the other hand, said nothing as my grandmother verbally let loose. Her pleasant facial expression and smile said to be calm and let my grandmother vent. I tried my best to comply and just sat there with my hands folded in my lap. To stop myself from crying, I bit my lip and focused on a small piece of wallpaper that had begun to peel away behind my grandmother's head. Many of the questions my grandmother asked me that day, she already knew the answers to, She most certainly had met my boyfriend and the father of my baby, because he'd been at the house a number of times. She even liked him. Or at least she seemed to. Still, she felt it necessary to go over all the details of how I could have gotten myself in the family way. She wanted reasons that day, but I had none for her. None that I wanted to share, that is. All I could manage to do was mumble I was sorry 1,000 times until I couldn't say it anymore and didn't want to say it again. We never know where the circumstances of our lives, good or bad, will lead us. Lord knows I sure didn't. I was so depressed prior to Shaquille's birth. I felt my life was essentially over before it had a chance to begin. I was 17 years old and just finishing high school when I found out I was pregnant. How would I rebound from having a baby so early in my life with no higher education or job skills? What kind of mother would I be when I was barely able to take care of myself? These questions haunted me prior to my son's birth and sent me spiraling down into a world of self-pity and self-doubt. But in truth, I knew my self-esteem issues didn't begin with Shaquille's future entree into the world. I'd battled with the residue of an unloving and unhappy childhood for years, which in turn caused me to look for love in all the wrong places. But I had no idea how to deal with the many confusing thoughts and feelings running through my young mind. I just knew I was heading in the wrong direction and needed to turn around before it was too late. We don't often see in our childhoods many things that are blatant to us as adults. I can't keep count of the number of people who have told me they never knew they were poor growing up until they were fully grown. Honestly, I wish I'd been that clueless about my own life. I unfortunately understood very early on that I wasn't growing up in what anyone would call a traditional family setting. It wasn't even close. My parents divorced when I was just 3 years old, and that left my older brother, Roy, younger sister Vivian, and me to be raised by my father and his family. The fact that my parents separated when I was very young impacted my life in ways that I can't begin to fully comprehend, not even today. That single event would go on to define how I felt, in both positive and negative ways, about the woman I would later become. Obviously, many people go through divorce and learn to deal with the aftermath of a family torn apart. However, for me and my two siblings, there were so many questions about what actually happened to our family and why. These are questions that wouldn't be answered until much later on. Chapter 2. Life ain't been no crystal stair. Though I was born in a little town called Dublin, Georgia, I have absolutely no memories of the Deep South or of the home where I most likely took my first steps. As soon as our parents went their separate ways in the late 1950s, my father and his family moved us by car to Newark, New Jersey. I can still vaguely recall sitting in a jam-packed car for what seemed like forever as we made our way up north. Neither my brother and sister nor I could even ask if we were there yet because we didn't know where there was. Looking back at how hastily we moved to our new city, it almost feels as though my father's family wanted to make sure our earliest memories of life and our mother were erased as quickly as they had been formed. Much later, my siblings and I would learn that we were moved to New Jersey so quickly because our mother wanted out of her marriage with our father. All I remembered during this time was that I didn't understand why our family wasn't like every other family I knew. All of the other families had a home with a mommy, a daddy, and children all living under one roof. There were always two parents, and certainly none of these families were moving to a new state to get away from each other. Nowadays, it's more common than not that children grow up in a single-parent household, but this was a time in African-American life when two parents in the home was a given. how things have changed today, and unfortunately for the worse. My family was different. When my father, brother, sister, and I first moved to Jersey, most of my father's family already lived in New Jersey, we shared the second floor of a crowded three-story building on South 8th Street. Our differences from other families in the neighborhood didn't end there, mind you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.